And I have observed that when you experience a certain amount of professional jealousy, you are able to become inured to it to the degree that you can actually make it a useful tool. And I've come up with an analogy that's a little bit disgusting, but I'm very proud of it. It turns out that there is, in medicine, a medicinal practice called maggot therapy. And maggot therapy is something that was originated in the Middle Ages and was used in the Civil War, and it has recently been introduced. And it's a little bit queasy-making, but it's very interesting. Turns out what they do, for if you happen to have a wound that won't heal, and in certain circumstances, doctors will place sterilized medicinal maggots into the wound and cover the wound. Of course, for some people this is psychologically impossible, but for those who can handle it, this is done. Well, these maggots have the ability to differentiate at an atomic level between necrotic tissue, which is dead, and clean, healthy tissue. So these things can go in and clean out better than any laser or the greatest doctor all of the dead tissue, and then when it's all done, they're removed and the wound will heal up. And I read about this the other day and I thought, that's amazing, and it's just so relevant to my situation and to the situation of young organists who, for instance, consider you're the bright light young organist of some small town in the Midwest, and you know, you're doing your best to be creative and get ready for a fancy conservatory, and you, as I did in my own hometown, can counter a huge amount of jealousy from the local organists who don't want to let you play the organ. They don't, you know, they badmouth you, et cetera, all this stuff. Or consider that you're in my situation and people make Facebook groups about how untalented and unmusical you are. Well, these people and these situations are sort of analogous to the medicinal maggots. Here you have the most disgusting insect imaginable. It eats dead things, okay? And it crawls around and it's slimy and yucky. But if you're willing to embrace it and take it into yourself, meaning if you're willing to actually get to know the people who badmouth you and talk to them, participate, hang around with them at organ conventions, and be nice to them and actually hear what they have to say, spend time with them, and from time to time check up online and see what they're saying about you, so that you can, instead of being hurt by it, take that information into you and allow it to inure itself to you. You become stronger. And just like the wound heals with the maggots, you see, these people are my maggots. Just like the the sick patient whose wound would not heal until this was introduced, I'm incredibly grateful. And, you know, it's a way, I mean, I don't mean to sound too elitist or superior. It's not like these people are maggots, they're people. I mean, they're wonderful, you know, people in their own right. But for an artist, I think especially when you're in a compromised field, the very most important thing you can do is to become strong. Not to become reactionary, as I initially did, but to become, as you grow up a bit, strong and secure in your own work, and in the fact that if you're doing something, anything of importance, particularly of cultural importance and impact, that there will be people around you, people who are wildly supportive, and that people who are wildly antagonistic and badmouth you constantly, and that this is in many ways a barometer of the impact you're having on a culture or on a work, and that it's important to stay right down the middle and actually to just listen to the artistic vision and not listen not only to the people who are negative, but not pay overly much attention to the people who are worshipfully positive, because the truth is somewhere between the two.
Absolutely. 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 Plus, I don't know too many organists who have a contract for, what, 5 more CDs?
Well, I mean, look, it's tempting to point at these things and say, well, so there, but then you're lowering to their level.
No. I mean, it's just, who buys CDs and who goes to concerts and who makes serious music possible? The people playing it, for sure, but without the people who just can't get enough of it, it all goes away.
This is so true. And, I mean, the people who are playing the organ today in America, by and large, need to do more. Not to make the organ popular. I mean, you hear so much talk about making the organ popular again. Well, this is a non sequitur at best. You don't hear pianists talking about making the piano popular. One does not go to hear Long Long Steinway, nor Yo-Yo Ma's cello. I do not go to hear Van Halen's guitar. You go to hear the artists. and it is not the instrument that draws. And I mean, I think Los Angeles is the perfect example of this, because you are the one place in the country who has a concert hall with a pipe organ that has actually been successful. There has been, well, I would describe it as a trend of putting pipe organs in concert halls that was since the last 20 years or so, but really started by, in some ways, the Meyerson Center in Dallas, where I just played a gorgeous organ, which then began to propagate the fashion of putting organs in concert halls, which led to, I think, the ultimate pipe organ in a concert hall anywhere in the world, which to me is pretty much indisputably the Walt Disney Concert Hall, the Glettergötz organ, which was also voiced by Manuel Rosales, an incredible combination of collaboration, not just between organ builders and voicers and artists, but also organ builders and architects. The Gary facade, of course, with the exploding organ, is probably the most iconic organ in the world, in both visually and in some ways sonically. And this is the one place here in Los Angeles where you have really been successful with an organ in a concert hall. It has been tried elsewhere, but to the degree that it's admitted publicly, is not as successful as here. And yet, what is Los Angeles known for musically? You're talking right now in your studio to a person who lives in the East Village of Manhattan, friend of Nico Muhly, a friend of many of the news-making composers and artists coming out of Juilliard, and also of my high school, the North Carolina School of the Arts. I know Los Angeles for contemporary music and for experimental art and film. This is one of the places in the world that's a center of artists who are using their identities to the full. And you are also the center of, in my opinion, concert hall architecture. You have the most visually and aesthetically identifiable and therefore fearless concert hall in the world, and the organ to match. This, to me, is a huge physical symbol of what I'm saying should be the approach adapted by the organ community and by young organists. Forget about the organ literally. Pay attention to the artist's identity. If the organ in Disney Hall had been contrived to be a polite-looking concert hall organ, it could be physically and mechanically and musically the same organ, but it would not make the sense that it does. This is a statement that derives from an artist's identity, namely that of Frank Gehry. Just as it is not the organ, or promoting the organ, or the degree of the place where the person studied, or, you know, how well they play this piece or that, that will sell audiences on coming to Organist X. It is Organist X, and what makes Organist X special and interesting, or controversial, or fashionable, or what have you, that will sell those tickets.
You forgot the F word.
How could I have forgotten the F word, my favorite word?
Fun.
Of course, fun.
The only sin that can be committed upon art, the only sin that can be committed upon music, make it boring. That's the only unforgivable sin.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And of course, you know, when you say fun, I don't necessarily think of course, as I've loved to play in the organ, Funérailles of Liszt, or necessarily Mephisto Waltz, which, well, it's certainly outwardly fun, is really about something extremely grim. I mean, this is a pact with the devil and the seduction of the innkeeper's daughter. But, yes, I mean, fun in the sense that the mind has got to have great places to go, places worth paying for and worth being there for. And if there's any instrument and body of instrumentalists who have committed the cardinal sin of eliminating or allowing fun to disappear from their music making, it is undeniably organists. But that, fortunately, is a correctable problem.
As we've been hearing all night long, as you will hear this coming Sunday at the Hollywood United Methodist Church, when the least boring organist I know, Cameron Carpenter, gives a recital. And come back with your next album. Come back whenever you're in town.
Oh, thank you. I'm so grateful for that. Thank you so much for the chance to speak here today.
My pleasure. Let's conclude with how his very first album concludes. Here again is Cameron Carpenter. Thank you.